Hello, this is the 10th Archvale Devlog. It's been quite a while since the last one, so there's quite a lot of stuff to talk about. So I'll talk about some of the new areas we've got in the game. The underground has basically been completely redone. So we've got a bunch of new stuff down there and the enemies have all been redesigned. The main mechanic down there are these little cobwebs that you'll find around, which slow your movement when you go through them, but you can break them with a sword. There's a bunch of spider enemies that will spawn these cobwebs. Had to add a spawn limit to make sure not too many cobwebs spawn, because that's bad. You'll come across little abandoned mines down in this place, so little chests and stuff will be there with some loot in. So this is going to be the second area of the game. You're going to spawn on the foresty area, and it's going to be an almost like island separate from the rest of the game world, so you'll go through this underground passageway to get to the main island. The next new biome is the glade. It's a kind of autumn themed biome, with like golden trees everywhere, with a bunch of wildlife like foxes and deer. We've also moved the bandits to this area, and so made them a bit harder, and this is the same area that you'll find the first dungeon, which will be a kind of bandit hideout underground. There's also all these little traps on the ground in some places, which when enemies walk over or you walk over, you'll take damage, so you can try and bait enemies to walk into them. So throughout this month, I've actually been refactoring quite an old system in the game. So obviously, since this is all procedural, like the decoration and the enemy placement, all of that is done in code and that's not drawn in unless I explicitly do so, which I can. But in general rooms that you're exploring, all of this has been randomly generated. And obviously there needs to be some boundaries set for what these things spawn, how the decoration looks, what decoration will spawn, how the enemies will spawn, how many enemies spawn. And all of this was in quite an old system, so I've rewritten it into a new biome definition system. So I'm going to walk you through how the forest biome is defined. So the first key component to a biome definition is a decorator, and a decorator is basically what is used to make things look a certain way. You could apply the forest decorator to absolutely any room, including like a dungeon room, and it would decorate it to look like a forest. So that's the kind of thing this does. This takes a bunch of parameters and will force it upon the level the game chooses to load. So there will be a set biome that you're in, the room will be loaded, and then this decorator will take care of changing all the tile sets and generating all the decoration. So we have some tiles here. So the first are the main tiles, so that's like the main solids and the little walls that protrude down from the main solids. So in the forest, it's the big trees with the kind of trunky looking brown part beneath. The secondary tiles are like a secondary set of tiles that behave the exact same way. So if I wanted like a building structure, which you can see in the little treasure rooms, then I can define what tiles they will use here. And then we've got the floor tiles. So that's the looping texture that's across the background, as well as the little noise tiles that you see generated. Next is the lighting. So you need a base color for the lighting before lights actually do anything. So here I've got -1s, which means use daylight. And along with the decorator lighting, you can also get a daylight mod, which is like a percentage modifier over daylight. So you could increase the amount of green, or the amount of red, or the amount of blue in the daylight, which might be something to do in like a snow biome, make it a bit bluer and darken the rest of it so that it's not quite as bright as all the other areas. Then we have the actual decorator, which will use both the decorator tiles and the decorator lighting to create an actual decorator definition. So the decorator needs a bunch of objects which it can spawn. So that's the add object call. So we provide the decorator we want to add the object to, the object, and then we provide any number of frequency distance pairs. Now a frequency distance pair is a new thing. Before, this distance value was just used as both the percentage chance to spawn, as well as how far away the new one must be from another one. So by that I mean, if a tree had a 10 distance, that would mean that there was a 1 in 10 chance for it to spawn, but it had to be at least 10 pixels away from the last one that spawned. Now, I can say that it will always spawn provided it's a certain distance away from the last one, or it will spawn 1 in 100 times regardless of how far it is from the last one, so that's decoupled now. And I can pass as many of these frequency distance pairs as I like, and it will randomly choose one of them when the biome is being decorated. Next, we can set up the canopies. These are kind of like the objects that spawn on top of the solid layer, so, you know, in the forest, that's these little treetops. And again, we can use the frequency distance pairs to say how far away and how often these spawn from each other. And then we set up our lighting and tiles, which just use those definitions we created before. Here I build a couple of extra definitions that have just different decoration in. It's usually a good idea to do these. It kind of helps with making everything look a bit different, and it's something that we're going to need to do more of in the future. I think we need to make a lot more of these decoration variants so that the rooms look more different, because right now they look very similar. Next up, we're defining our enemies, which is a more complicated process. So we start with enemy collections. So an enemy collection is like a group of enemies that spawn within a little area of each other. So we create a new enemy collection, and this is where we define how many members this enemy collection can have. So in this one, the slime one, we have 2 to 4. So a minimum of 2 slimes will spawn and a maximum of 4 will. Then we can add members to our collection. A member is a candidate to be spawned. So the first one is the first slime, the brown slime, and the second one is the pink slime. The final value is a kind of weight value, so it means that 2 out of 3 of these will be a slime 1 and 1 of 3 will be a slime 2. Obviously these groups can be as big as you want, so they could be built used to build quite complicated groups of enemies. You can also define the maximum number of an enemy candidate that can be spawned inside of a group. So you might just want one big guy in the group, so you can set him to only spawn once, and you can even give them a very large weight so that it's very likely they will spawn. Right now I don't have a way to say this is a guaranteed member. Might be something to add in the future. It's a thing that should be noted that this doesn't necessarily need to actually spawn enemies. So I could kind of cheat this system. Nuclear Throne, for example, always spawns explosive barrels quite close to enemies, so I could actually say that an explosive barrel is a candidate of an enemy group, so that an explosive barrel will spawn around a load of enemies. Next up, we have enemy collection groups. Now, this defines a series of enemy collections that can spawn, and the maximum number of those enemy collections that can spawn. So for example, in a given forest room, if we pick this group slimes crows group, that means there's going to be slimes and there's going to be crows, obviously. We have weightings for which group will spawn along with a maximum count. So our collection slime has a weighting of 3, whereas the other two have a weighting of 2 and 1. So the just normal slime collection has that greatest chance of spawning. And we've got a -1 as the max, which means any number can spawn. There's no limit to how many of these can spawn. On the flip side, we've got the slime large collection, which can only spawn a maximum of 2 times. You'll never get more than 2 groups of large slimes in the room. The crows have the low chance to spawn, but you can spawn as many of those as you want, so you might get a room just full of crows. Now finally, where all of this actually gets used are the biome areas. Now a biome area is a collection of decorators and an enemy group. So the decorators again are all weighted, so you can add a decorator and give it a weight. So you might only want one decorator. You might always want these rooms to look the same, or you might want them to look slightly different each time. But you can define the constraints on how different they will look by, you know, limiting which ones you choose to use. If you create a really crazy looking decorator, you might want to save that for a room with special enemies in it. When we set our enemy group, or our enemy collection group, that should really be called, we define the maximum and minimum number of groups that can actually be spawned. This is like the final, there can only be 2 or 3 groups of enemies in this area. That's it. And then finally, we add the area to the biome definition, and we give it a weight. So again, we've got weighting here, which means, you know, we could say most of the rooms are going to be the mixture of all, but we could have an off chance of a room with maybe some slimy decoration, which is full of more slimes, only slimes, and perhaps more than usual. But that's a very rare room. that could be a thing to do. So that's how the new definitions work. Now, something that I've realized in development is that whilst I can, as described in one of the last videos, we can place biomes as we like across the world map, and we know where they link, and we can generate a bunch of these templates to create a bunch of usable worlds in the right sequence. However, it's kind of boring to travel across the same biome for many, many rooms with just random chances for... It's just like noise of these different rooms. So there's I can kind of cheat my own system here by creating sub-biomes. Now, when I say a sub-biome, basically the sub-biome inherits almost everything from the main biome. So for example, the forest, we could have two parts to. This is what we used to have when we had the bandits. We had a kind of clean forest and then a bandit forest far north. So the bandit forest had a bunch of rooms that could have the nasty bandits in it. The clean forest had absolutely no chance of having bandits in it. So it means that once you go to the far north, you'll start seeing bandits and you'll start seeing tents and campfires. And it creates a cool kind of dynamic as you explore the world and actually see it changing. This is also useful for making sure that certain special rooms go in certain areas, because I can actually say, add this special room to only this sub-biome. So for example, in the current game, I've got a section at the very far south of the forest biome, which is just a tiny little area where the town spawns and the player spawns. So the player is guaranteed to be very close to the town when they start the game. Then it breaks out into the main forest, which if I add a room to, it could be anywhere. That's completely random there, but I can actually kind of force things into special areas. So that's going to be really useful for creating some cool world things, like, you know, the town is over to the far west of an area, and the enemies are over to the far east, and the town are scared of the enemies, or the enemies have stolen something from the town, so you've got a little trek to get from one place to the other. Combat currently is pretty good. I'm pretty happy with combat, but we're missing a pretty big thing to try and make combat a bit more complicated. From watching people play, I've noticed that people do tend to swap weapons an awful lot. Like, most people will be using three weapons at least when they're fighting, like constantly swapping between them, which is really good. That's a really good thing, because that means there's some nice layers to the combat there that encourage you to be swapping, and it means that the weapons are balanced right. But there could still be a bit more, and that extra is coming in the form of right-click abilities. The right-click ability is a single equip slot, so you put an item in it, and that will give you a right-click ability. So it's just like armor in that sense, you know, it's an equipable thing, and you can use it at any time whilst fighting, and it'll do a pretty strong attack. I've only got this one in at the moment, but they're very easy to add. So this one just fires a lot of arrows once you've charged it up. Now, charging it up is the design problem that I faced here, and we spoke about this quite a lot, me and Fops, trying to work out the best way to recharge these items. So there's a few options. The standard way of doing it is cooldowns. Now, I don't really want to do cooldowns in this game for one main reason. Once you've cleared rooms, enemies aren't going to spawn again. It's not impossible that they could. We could set that up if it feels right. It might be good for areas where you're mining, but dungeons, I don't really want the enemies coming back once you've cleared the room. And encouraging people to just sit in an empty room until a recharge is done is kind of really lame, especially if we end up having quite long recharge times on abilities. So I've ruled that out. Another possibility, thanks to how we've cut up the rooms in our game, would be to recharge based on rooms cleared. Obviously, this would mean that right-click abilities recharge very slowly, and they'd end up being a really significant choice to use, which is kind of not really where we're going with them. Could work for something bigger, but right-click abilities are meant to be a kind of, you know, use them regularly in combat. We could have said that you charge them whilst fighting, like whilst you're in combat, they're regularly charging, so once you've cleared a room, it stops charging, so you need to be actively in combat. But I'm worried that this would again encourage leaving like one enemy and just sitting and waiting for your thing to recharge whilst like just lazily dodging this enemy or cheesing it out of the way somewhere. It would be cool to do a bullet hell like system where it recharges when you're close to bullets. That's quite a common thing in bullet hells, gaining points for kind of skimming on the edge of projectiles, so that might be something to consider. But again, we've got the problem of players leaving just one enemy that's easy to dodge just to grind off its projectiles to recharge. The thing I've settled on for now, which may not work at all, is recharging based on the damage you deal. We were considering either number of times you hit an enemy, or the amount of damage you deal. Number of times you hit an enemy means you're giving a bias to high fire rate weapons, which already have a bias because they're inherently better. So that's a bad idea. So I settled on damage. So the good thing about doing damage based instead of something like enemy kills, because that's another option, you know, recharge based on enemy kills, is that it will naturally recharge in boss fights. Enemy kills means that you'll have the thing once in a boss fight, and unless it spawns minions, you're not going to get it again. Unless we build some special mechanic that recharges it, but that seems like just a whole other thing, and it seems it's going to become a bit overcomplicated. The problem with using damage is that there's this new possibility that in the end game, when you're dealing the amount of damage you're doing in the early game in a really short period of time, it might end up beneficial to equip an early game special ability and like rapid fire spam it like crazy, because you're dealing so much damage at that point that the damage threshold to recharge an early game item would be nothing to you, so you could spam it non-stop. So these are all problems. It's a very hard thing to work out. We could try things like a kind of buffer time. So, you know, you recharge a chunk of it and then slowly it ticks up to that chunk, like two bars essentially. But everything we think of here seems a bit overcomplicated. So this is something I'm going to have to work on a lot because, you know, this is a really complicated thing to design. Anyway, that will probably do for this devlog. Hopefully the next one will have less of a gap. You can join our Discord in the description, where I'm quite active and there's a bunch of really cool people talking all the time about game dev and sometimes about Archvale.